I come from an internet marketing background. I had an e-commerce company for 7 years. Started Q4 Launch 7 years ago, and we have been focused the last 4 years exclusively in the travel space and get to work with some of the best properties all over the world at this point. And one of my favorite things to do is to get to travel and go out and see our customers. Although right now I am glad to be home. My wife and I are welcoming our first baby, or have just welcomed our first little girl, Evelyn Joy, and it's an exciting time for me to be home for a month or so before heading back on the road in January. So a little bit about Q4 Launch. We specialize in helping travelers discover destinations. We partner with brands, properties, companies like yours to help you reach more travelers when they're planning their vacation. So today we're really going to dive into the nuts and bolts of how to develop your 2016 marketing plan, and excited to bring this topic to you today. We taught a similar webinar last year on how to develop your 2015 plan, although I will say that this year's plan is pretty drastically different than the content we presented last year, and that comes out of just a lot of the things we see in the marketplace and a lot of the questions that we get asked. So really want to try to address those and help you all get off to a great start in planning your 2016. To kind of set the table for that, one of the things in some of the research we do and some of the goal setting groups that I'm in with other entrepreneurs, they have found that companies that start the year with a great first quarter tend to carry that momentum forward and outperform companies for the rest of the year that don't start the year as strong. And that makes sense, right? I mean, that if you start the year strong, you'll finish the year strong, hopefully. But what that tells me and what that means for us today is, and kudos to you for being here and taking that seriously, now is the time where you have to be setting the vision, setting the strategy, communicating that to your team, even if you're a team of one, communicating that, documenting that, so that when January 2nd hits, which is actually a Saturday, so maybe it's January 4th this year, and the New Year's Eve hangover has worn off, if that's something you participate in, that Monday, you are hitting the ground running 100 miles an hour. What we see in the travel space, in the travel industry, is that January and February are typically pretty big booking months. People have been talking about the vacation they want to take. They've been planning over the holidays with friends and family. And then January happens, and there's kind of a deluge of initial bookings. So you have to be positioning yourself now to take advantage of that. And like I said, kudos to you, probably preaching to the choir a little bit as you're here in December having this conversation. So excited that you guys are along for the ride, excited that you've taken that initiative, and looking forward to getting you some resources to help you down that journey today. A little bit of housekeeping. We're going to use the chat panel for questions and answers at the end of our time together today. We've got a lot of content together, so no surprise to those of you who have been with us before. You know I talk fast, move really quick, so buckle up and be ready for that. We're going to continue that trend today. I told somebody last week, as they were laughing with me about that off the HomeAway webinar, that I'd rather give you an hour and a half of content in an hour than give you 10 minutes of content in an hour. Everybody's been on those webinars where you get 10 minutes of content strung over 60 minutes, and everybody hates that. So we really try to do the opposite and just jam-pack a ton of value into this hour for you. So we're going to move quick, get a lot done in that period of time. We will also make a recording of today's session available for those of you that need to slow it down a bit and take notes and really think through. And that's a lot of us, right? I mean, that's how you're going to learn the best, is to take this content, listen to it again, and then start developing your plan from there. Because we're going to move quick enough today, you're not going to have time to develop your plan today. You're going to have to go back, listen to it, and do that. So keep an eye on your inbox. We'll be sending you a copy of our recording. If you want to be one of the first to receive it, you can go subscribe to us on YouTube, actually. If you subscribe to us on YouTube at youtube.com/Q4Launch, you will get the first notifications that the recording is live and posted there. Otherwise, we will send it out to everybody via email who has registered today. If you know a friend who needs to hear this message or would be helpful, they can register for the webinar after it's already finished, and we'll send a copy of it to everybody who registers, even though the webinar has been completed. So you can forward that information along to them. I think that's it. I think that's all the housekeeping and things we wanted to touch base on, and let's just start diving in and getting into the meat of our content together here today. So here we go. All right. As we look ahead at 2016, and everybody's excited about that and what that means, and I love this time of year being a goal setter. It's a really exciting time of year for me. But we have to spend some time looking back at and reviewing 2015. What we kind of refer to it as, we have to check our business's pulse. As we talk to different people around the travel space and really focusing on the independent side of that, we all know we're stretched a little thin. And the routine message we have or that we hear from people is people are not stopping running their business long enough to really check on their business and say, okay, let's go to that doctor, let's get that checkup, let's have our annual physical, if you will, to really be able to figure out what's going on. And this is the time of year you really need to stop and do that and get that checkup on what's going on. So we refer to your pulse or your business's pulse. And what we're really referring to when we say that is your analytics. And when you really monitor it on a daily basis, this is a graph has been smoothed out on a monthly curve, so it smoothed out a lot of those lines. But if I had this chart up there on the daily curve, you'd see a lot of blips, and it actually kind of looks similar to a heartbeat monitor. So that actually kind of has that visual representation of what's going on with your business's pulse as well. But as you're doing that, we really want to spend time doing an in-depth analysis of your Google Analytics. And we're going to ask you a lot of questions as we move throughout our time together here today. But really want you, as we're asking these questions, to process that, write down your answer, or to come back to it and write down your answer as you're kind of processing the whole webinar and what we're learning together today. So when was the last time you did an in-depth Google Analytics analysis? Not just a quick, oh, my traffic's up good, and then you're on to the next thing, but really diving in to individual traffic sources. What's up, what's down, what's working for you? And as you're thinking about what's worked this year compared to your strategy last year, hopefully you've made some significant changes in your marketing strategy last year. As you're thinking about that, you really have to dive into the analytics to understand that. And we're going to do that at a pretty surface level today, and then hopefully make some opportunities available for you to do that at a much more in-depth level later on in the call. Awesome. So here we go. Let's start diving into this. The first thing we want to really understand is what are your highest performing traffic sources? And this is great because this is the way that Google Analytics is set up default to show you information. And that's your highest performing sources that are bringing traffic to your site. So getting in, looking at those things, looking at where traffic is coming from, and these highest performing sources, see how they're performing year over year. In this case, we see Google Organic Direct Traffic as our number one, number two. That's pretty typically what we'll see. If you're not there, there's some reasons maybe for that, but we can talk about those at another time. But Google Organic, in most cases, is the number one source of traffic. So in this particular person's case, organic traffic is up 57% year over year. Love that. Feeling good about it. Direct traffic is up 15%. You know, that's up. That's good. Nothing to write home about, although I'm sure many of us would be happy with a 15% increase. This next one here is a referral source. And to protect the privacy of that referral source, we've blocked that out. But that's down 20.7%. That's alarming, right? So we need to be talking to that referral source, figure out what's going on, why is their traffic down so much, and what do we need to change part of our strategy, or how do we replace that traffic? And then email marketing coming in at number four, we'll see that a lot as well. People that are actively doing email marketing, it's typically going to be the third, fourth, or fifth source of overall traffic to the website. So if you're not doing email, which we'll talk about later, there you go. It should be your third, fourth, or fifth largest source of traffic to your site. And then finally, TripAdvisor traffic, you know, just down 1.97%. So pretty much negligible difference there. But you've got to understand these highest performing traffic sources and then filter this data year over year to see how it's performing year over year. So that can really help you as you're trying to understand what are our best performing traffic sources. On the flip side of that, we also, and it may even be more important, but want to understand what are our worst performing traffic sources year over year. Not necessarily worst in that they brought us the least amount of traffic, but what sources are down the most year over year. And as we look through that, it's really important because it helps us understand where are we losing traffic this year we had traffic from next year. I actually just wrapped up a call and was on the phone with somebody and I saw that they had a referral traffic source that was down by about 2,000 visits year over year. And it was really good quality traffic. So if we assume that they had a 2% conversion ratio, meaning 2% of the traffic from that source actually converted into bookings, and they were down 2,000 visits, it's also safe to correlate that assumption or to extrapolate that assumption, excuse me, and say, okay, 2,000 visits at a 2% conversion ratio means we've lost 40 bookings from that source. And that's some ballpark math, but once you start putting it in those terms and you say 40 bookings, my average booking is $500 a piece, it starts to really monetize what that means and what that traffic is down. And then you know, okay, is this something I should be concerned about, or is this something I need, I can go on, you know, without having to be too much concerned. So really helping you understand that and helping you understand how do you need to develop a game plan with some of these traffic sources that are down. If you go to that source and they say, well, that's just the way it is, then you know from a marketing perspective, you have to develop a plan to replace that traffic and ultimately, and more importantly, replace the bookings you were getting from that source. Or in this case, the 40 bookings we estimated were coming from that source. Now we have to figure out how we can replace those bookings and build a marketing plan to be able to do that on top of trying to grow our business in 2016. Next thing we really want to dive into here is looking at what pages on your site are serving as landing pages most often. And what that really means is where are people entering your website? I use some of the technical language there just so you can actually see it and find it in Google Analytics. We're trying to use the same language that Analytics has in it. But if you go into the behavior part of Analytics, and then you go into site content landing pages. So you've got that left menu down the side, the menu down the left side. Look for behavior, look for site content, look for landing pages, and you'll be able to see the top landing pages your site has, where people are entering your website. And this is really important because this, in today's modern marketing world where things have changed quite a bit in the last few years, this should be changing pretty significantly. The data you see here should be very different than the data that you've seen in years past as far as where people are entering your site. You know, a lot of people assume people enter the site through the homepage, and that's a fair assumption, but in this particular customer's case, 72.7% of people entered the website via the homepage, which means roughly 27% of people entered the website on other pages. So over 25% of our traffic entered our website on another page. And that's important for us to know because we have to then think about what the design of those pages look like. Because if someone's entering the website through another page, you've got to really think about what's that user experience like on that page that they're entering the website through. So a really important thing to think about, understand, and also be able to build marketing strategies around driving traffic to enter the site in other parts of your site. Not everybody needs to go to your homepage. If it's a repeat customer that's already done business with you in the past, they don't really need to go to your homepage. They already know the content that's there. They don't need that traffic direction that your homepage really serves to do. They're going to go deeper. Or if you have a good content marketing strategy, that's going to help people enter your website in other parts of the site than they have in years past. As you look at this, we actually see that people coming to the homepage has gone up 17.7%. But as far as the percentage of people that entered the site through the homepage versus other parts of the site, that's actually gone down year over year. And that's a good thing because we want that to go down because it means people are entering our site in other places via other marketing strategies. And that's one of the things we've worked to help this customer create is people entering the website in different places to help drive people deeper into the site and a more custom experience for those individual people. So lots of cool things you can do when you think about your marketing like this and look at where people are entering your entering your pages or entering your website. So again, that's going to be found on the left sidebar of your Google Analytics. Go down to Behavior, Site Content, Landing Pages is where you'll find this report. And of course, it's going to be much deeper than this. It's just a quick screenshot of what's in that report. Awesome. We're going to dive into some specific marketing mediums here now over the next few minutes. And you'll see this graph looks very much like that heart rate monitor I was talking about. But how is your email marketing performing? Email marketing absolutely has to be a part of your marketing strategy in 2016. It is the area, as we've talked to people this year, that they spend the least amount of time pursuing. But I'm here to tell you it provides the highest ROI. So for me as a business owner, that tells me things are a little bit backwards from a marketing perspective. Other business owners are spending the least amount of their time on email marketing as a marketing medium, but those that are doing it are seeing the highest ROI, which means to me your number one priority in 2016, if you did nothing else but one thing, would be to increase the effectiveness at which you're doing email marketing. If it's going to provide the highest ROI, and we know you have limited time and resources, it's the number one thing you should be looking at investing in 2016. Of course, that's a blanket statement. You've got to kind of filter that through what's going on in your business and your marketplace, but it's a tremendous opportunity. And if you've been on our webinars in the past, you know we almost always, as we're talking about marketing, start with a conversation about email because of how powerful it is, yet how few people are using it really, really well. There is nothing else that can drive these type of traffic spikes. And as you're analyzing this, there's a couple things we want to analyze. One, and you can't probably see it because the font's a little small there, but you see that one spike that's about 3/4 of the way through the chart. That actually is August of 2015, and that spike is significantly higher than all the other spikes. So what that tells me, if I'm in my analytics, I'm going to scroll over that, I'm going to find that exact date, and let's say, what email campaign did I send on August 15th of 2015, and why did it perform so well? Was it just that that's a peak month for me and that's just seasonality at work, or was there something else about that campaign that I need to learn from? And going back and diving into that campaign, really analyzing why was that campaign so successful and others weren't. And in that same vein, I want to understand what were some of my lowest performing campaigns. And as we look at this chart, we'll see about 1/4 of the way through that chart in March of 2015, there's two little blips that we see from email. Those are our two lowest performing email campaigns of the year. And that the same reason we want to understand what happened, that our highest performing campaign was so great, why was our lowest performing campaign so bad? And that's an important thing to consider. And we see these little blips getting relatively bigger throughout the year. That's because we're learning from every campaign we're sending out. And the next one, we're always trying to make that a little bit better. It doesn't work perfectly every time. Sometimes there's other factors at play. Sometimes we try stuff that doesn't work, but we want to be learning and testing to improve our email marketing on a constant basis, learning from our successes, learning from our failures, and changing our strategy going forward to make that work better. So really encouraging you to dive into that analytics to understand what's going on with your email marketing and start sending those campaigns twice a month if you haven't already. The next thing we're going to look at, and this is such a major shift in the way people are discovering destinations. If you have been following our webinars for all of 2015, you might have came to a webinar we did at the beginning of the year on our top travel marketing predictions for 2015. And on that webinar, we talked about the fact that we thought people were going to change the way they were discovering content and discovering destinations on the web. And we built a lot of our strategies this year around that prediction. And we're here to tell you that that prediction came true for the customers we implemented it for. And what that means is that people really discovered a lot of our customers' destinations and our customers' properties through their blogs. The blog worked tremendously well for us this year to drive a significant amount of traffic. In this case, again, you probably can't read it, but 5,500 people through the first 11 months of the year discovered this property, this destination, through their blog. So 5,500 people who weren't looking for them, they weren't looking for this place, discovered them by searching for something else or doing something else that then led them to their website. So it's not people who are already looking for you. It's not people who are already looking for a bed and breakfast or a boutique hotel or a vacation rental in your city. This is people who are just planning a trip in general and are discovering you. Now that they've discovered you, they see how beautiful your property is, how beautiful your grounds are, they see how beautiful all of that is, and they have the opportunity to book with you because they've discovered you in the first place. But if they haven't discovered you, they don't know you exist. So this has been a tremendous success this year, and we're telling you that to say it's a tremendous opportunity for you as you're headed into your 2016 strategy to really say, what part of my campaign does blogging need to fit into? And if you decided you were on that predictions webinar or you were on some other webinar we did throughout the year or you were talking to somebody else and decided to invest into blogging, now is really the time to go back and analyze how well did this work. And look at people that entered your website via the blog and see what role it played to help people find you. Again, if people are entering your website via the blog, it means that's how they found you. That's how they discovered you. So go in and analyze that. Analyze the individual blog posts. If these little gray bars weren't here, you'd see blog post names. Again, we've kind of blocked those out for privacy reasons, but you could see the best performing blog posts. And you might even go back, and what we do is we'll often check on those posts. And if we see a post that's getting some traffic, but maybe not as much as we would have expected, we'll go check it and find, oh, it's on the second or maybe the third page. And we'll go in and we'll make additional tweaks to get it from second or third page. onto the first page. So a lot of opportunities there to really continue to drive improvement, drive change, and drive more traffic to your site, which again, traffic is all about people discovering your property via that blog. So it's a really important thing to track and measure. Next thing we want to look at, and it's we talk about this as well quite a bit, and it's less important, we believe, than some of our other marketing mediums, but it still has to play a role. And that's, is your social media audience growing? You know, we need to have an audience following us in social media. So when we have a marketing message we need to get out, whether that's last minute availability or cancellations or whatever the message is we need to get out, we have an audience we can reach with that message. Granted, it might have to be a paid reach, right, through a boosted post, but you can still get the opportunity to reach them if you invested in building that audience in the first place. And that's why growing it is so important. And that's why we set a goal to grow at 5 to 10% per month. Of course, understanding percentages vary based on how big your page is as a to start with. But setting a goal to be aggressive about growing your social media following this year, so when you have that message, you can get that message out quickly. One thing I will say, though, on social media, sorry, I had to pause there to get a little drink of coffee to keep myself fueled up for our time together. But one thing I will say from that perspective is as you're building that social media following, you have to really be making sure you're getting engagement from those people as well. It's important to be getting that engagement from people because that's really what's going to drive people to connect with you in the long run. So really be looking at growing your following and growing your engagement along that. One other thing I'll note and why I've stressed the importance of social media, as we talk to people and have traveled all over the U.S. this year speaking at conferences and done hundreds of GoToMeeting calls to help people with their marketing, usually when I ask people the area that they're investing the most amount of marketing time into, the response is social media. And I don't ask the question just like that because it kind of gets obvious what you're really trying to get to, but I phrase that question a few different ways to see how many people are investing time and or money into social media. And as we analyze that, we find that people are investing the majority of their marketing time into social media. And that's okay to a certain extent, and I think the reason for that is it's the easiest marketing medium to invest time into. It feels the most natural, flows the most naturally for people throughout their kind of current rhythms. But they're spending the most amount of time and or money in this medium, and it's the medium that we see has the lowest ROI. So I talked about the email marketing as the least amount of time but the highest ROI. Social media is the polar opposite of that. People spend the most amount of time here, yet it has the lowest direct ROI of any marketing medium. So that tells us there's got to be a flip, right? In 2016, you've got to be thinking about your marketing differently. And if you're falling into that that audience today that is the most amount of time but the least ROI from social media, and the flip side of that with email marketing, you've got to really be changing the way you're looking at that in 2016 to develop a specific strategy. Awesome. So let's dive into some of those questions I referenced earlier, some of those things that have you thought about some of these things. As we're developing our plan for 2016, we've got to ask ourselves some tough questions. The first, and I didn't get it in my slides, I meant to, so I'm going to ask it, but I don't have a slide. And I mentioned it earlier, but how many of us have made a significant change in our marketing strategy in 2016? We've done something dramatically different in 2015. Excuse me. How many of us have done something dramatically different in 2015 than we did in 2014? Usually when we ask that question in person, there's about a third of the group that has a show of hands. But we follow that up with the question of, well, how many want their 2016 to look dramatically different than their 2015 from a bookings perspective? We really want to grow our business this year. And usually the majority of people raise their hand for that. Some people don't. They're happy with the size of their business, and that's great. We applaud you for that. But if you want 2016 to be dramatically different than 2015, if you want to grow your business, you have to be willing to make a major change in your marketing strategy. And we're talking about some of those major changes today, but you've got to be willing to make change if you want different results. Otherwise, you fall into that definition of insanity from Albert Einstein, doing the same thing again and again and expecting different results. And I think, unfortunately, a lot of us get really busy in our business life, which is good, but we get so busy and we get caught up with the sake of being busy and feeling productive that we really forget to make intelligent changes in our marketing strategy to drive dramatically different results. So if you're here today and you're thinking, I want to grow my business next year, my plug for you, my rah-rah for you is be willing and open to making a significant change in 2016 and trying some of the things that we're laying out for you today. Here are some of those other questions we want to really be looking at. How many of you are happy with your bookings or your revenue for 2015? We talked about that a little bit and kind of dove into some of those different questions we ask as a part of that. How many of you, or do you want to be less reliant on online travel agents or OTAs in 2016? They're doing everything they can to grow their share of the marketplace. And we talked about that in our webinar last week about Expedia buying HomeAway and some of the potential risks that come from being heavily reliant on that. But it's a really important thing to be asking yourself. You may say, I'm in a market dominated by that, and I'm okay with that, and I'm okay with paying 20 or 25%. Commission to those sites, and that's just the way it's going to be, and that's great. And if that's your strategy, you know, that could work for you. I'm not saying that's the wrong strategy. Again, it's specific to your market, but you've got to be thinking about your brand and what role does your brand play in this overall marketing plan of yours. And then the next question is a very similar question, but do you want to be less reliant on third-party directories in 2016? I would say that's probably the most common thing that we're hearing coming out of our all of our conversation, our blog post that got so much activity about a month ago, and then the follow-up webinar we did last week as a result of that. A lot of people are having that realization that they need to be less reliant on third-party directories. Otherwise, they're ultimately just a puppet of those directories, and they have to go along with whatever the puppet master says. If that means they're going to double listing prices, or that means they're going to start charging more fees, or they're going to start charging a customer a 6% fee and you're not excited about that, or whatever it is, you're just a puppet to those changes unless you really can pull away from them because you have a strong brand, a strong demand channel, or strong branded marketing channel of your own to generate business through. And we encourage everybody to really think about being less reliant on third-party directories because that's how you build the value of your brand. Tremendous opportunity to increase the value of your brand and the value of your company by having that strong direct booking channel. And then, of course, that question we've referenced there, that does the Expedia acquisition of HomeAway have you a bit nervous? So many of you shared feedback with us via email and via phone calls and via the sign-up form for that webinar about what your thoughts were on it, and we appreciate that. And hopefully we've gotten back to everybody. If you have a question on that and we haven't, please do email us and let us know how we can help you with that. But a lot of people are a bit nervous about what that means in the overall unique side of the lodging sector. Are we just going to become a part of this kind of major conglomerate and be up there with all the Marriotts and Hiltons of the world? And that's not really where our customer is or who we're trying to reach. So what's going on and how do we have a strategy to address that as we look ahead at 2016? 2016 is going to be a dramatically different marketing year than 2015 was for many of us, and it has to be dramatically different for us to succeed in the year ahead. And as we look at that, we say it really starts with developing a successful marketing strategy, right? If you have that successful strategy, it's going to help you sleep easier at night. It's going to help you track the performance of what you're doing. It's going to help you grow your business in 2016. So you've got to start with developing that successful marketing strategy. You have to say, are you happy with your current results? Back to that question we asked earlier. And if you're not happy with your current results or you're happy with them but you want to see them better in 2016, you've got to be willing to make significant change to get there and embrace that change. You have to set goals and you have to define objectives to support those goals. I talked earlier about being very goal-driven, and we work through that with our customers. We're very goal-oriented as a company, and we ask for goals with every customer we're working with because it's that accountability that's important for everybody that's working that direction, knowing you're on the same page, knowing you have accountability, you have a goal that you're working towards, and then defining that as far as individual objectives that you can be working toward that are going to accomplish those goals. A lot of what we're talking about is kind of setting that vision for the year as a whole, but then you have to work backwards on a quarterly, monthly, weekly, daily basis. What do I need to do quarterly, weekly, monthly, weekly, daily to make sure that I'm achieving the goal that I set for myself for the year as a whole, my quarterly goal, my monthly goal, my weekly goal, my daily goal? I've got to be making sure I'm working towards those things to drive success and then having those waypoints to say, okay, am I on pace? Am I headed where I want to go? Am I tracking on the path I want to be on as you're working towards those things? So developing the big picture strategy, which is really what we're talking about today, but then breaking that down on a daily, weekly, monthly, quarterly basis and knowing what it's going to take to succeed. And then how are you going to measure that, right? So you've got this big vision. You're excited. You're going to grow your business by X. You're going to do all these things. You've got your goals. You've got your objectives. How are you going to measure your return on investment? And don't forget about the fact that marketing is an investment in the growth of your business, right? You've got to change that perspective a little bit there, too. We're talking a lot about change today, but it's a good time of year to do it. A lot of people we talk about, they're driven by the accounting philosophy that marketing is an expense, and it shows up on your P&L as an expense. In our belief, marketing is an investment. As such, you should expect to have a return on your investment. You're faced with decisions every day. Where do you invest your money and time? The two scarcest resources we have are money and time. And you have to decide every day, every hour, where you're going to invest those two resources. And as such, you have to think about what's my expected return on that investment as well. Some of that's very financially motivated. Some of that's, hey, I want to get a percentage return of X on my marketing investment. I'm going to measure that by how much I grow my business in the coming year. Some of our customers have told us, Matt, if you could just generate 100% return on your investment, meaning you pay for yourself, we would consider that success because I know that means I'm going to get 10 hours a week back that I'm spending on this right now, and I can invest that time into this other area of my business, and I'm going to grow that part of my business. Or it means I can invest my time back into my hobbies and my passions, and I'm going to have a higher quality of life because of that. Or I'm going to invest that time into my kids or my grandkids, and that's going to really be success for me. You've got to think about what that means for you. ROI isn't always just about money. It's a combination of this money and time balance and understanding what that looks like. But you have to know going into that investment what your plan to measure the return is. Whether that's an investment of time or money, how are you going to measure that return and determine if something's been successful? Otherwise, you're a political candidate. You've got hope and a prayer, and you're just wanting to, we're just wanting to make sure it works. Hopefully, we've got a little bit more solid strategy than our political candidates do these days with hope and a prayer. That's a whole different issue, though. As you're diving into that, what marketing methods are right for you? What's right for you isn't the same thing as what's right for everybody. We work with destinations across the world, urban, country, high-end, somewhat high-end. We don't work with any kind of low-end destinations. We really work with the upper end of the market. But our customers typically have average daily rates or average booking rates between $200 and $2,000 a night. And when you think about a property that's booking between $200 and $2,000 a night, that's a different audience. It's a different segment. And you're going to reach those people differently than someone who's trying to book a $69 a night motel room. This is a very different strategy. So what marketing methods are right for you? Is a certain level of OTA or online travel agency involvement right for you? It very well may be, but what percentage seems like the right percentage? Are third-party directories an important part of your marketing strategy? Probably, but what part of that marketing strategy should they be playing? And then diving that same conversation through all the other marketing mediums we're going to look at today to really understand what's right for you and what's the best fit to help you accomplish the goals and objectives you're working towards this year. And then really taking some time, you know, I think this is one of those things where you've got to go to a quiet place and process this and really answer these questions for yourself. If you don't have the answers to these questions today, that's okay. That just means you got some work to do. And all of us, no matter where we are in this process, have some work to do as we look ahead at the coming year. But getting to that quiet place and really diving in and answering some of these questions. We're going to shift gears a little bit. Now, so far, we've been kind of talking about analyzing and then kind of setting goals and planning a little bit. The next half of our time together, we're really going to be looking at what does it take to execute some of this stuff and really make it work, some of these strategies and make it work. And as we do that, we want to get inside the mind of a vacationer a little bit. If you've been with us on webinars in the past, you've heard this from us. If this is your first time with us, again, welcome. We want to introduce you to this. It frames a lot of the discussions and the decisions we make from a marketing company and from the marketing perspective we have and the decisions we make as a company. In 2011, Google released a study that said the vacation process really consisted of five steps or the travel cycle. And it wasn't mind-blowing at the time, but if you really allow it to get into your mind, it will really change the way you think about things. The first was dreaming. The second was planning. The third was booking. The fourth was experiencing. And the fifth was remembering. I think a lot of us are really focused on that booking phase, and that's great, right? I mean, that's where money changes hands, so that's important. But if we're so focused on booking that we forget about dreaming and planning, and I'm here to tell you most of us do because we see that in the marketing that comes out, not addressing dreaming and planning so well, you've essentially ignored two-thirds of the sales cycle by doing that. And that's a really important thing. And if you're thinking about the remembering stage, you know, people have taken a great trip. They've had this great experience with you. Now they're remembering that vacation. How do you develop a marketing strategy to help them remember that vacation that they had, help them remember that experience they had? And if you're doing marketing well, but we believe this goes from a linear cycle, like Google study laid it out, to a cyclical process, where great marketing to somebody who's in the remembering stage starts the dreaming stage all over again. And if you get them back to dreaming and you do great marketing to them there, you'll pull them into the planning stage. Great marketing there will pull them into the booking stage. And the important thing is they actually have to book with you, right? Just getting them to plan another vacation isn't enough. You got to get them to book it with you. So you've got to be thinking about these things as you're developing your marketing strategy. If you'll really filter your marketing decisions through this, this inside the mind of a vacationer, these five steps of the travel cycle, I think you'll see dramatically different marketing coming out of your own mind, your own thought process in the year ahead. And as you're having conversations with people that are helping you with marketing, this is an important thing to be thinking about as well and making sure they understand, because it's very different for everybody. What really takes to succeed in this space is very different than what it takes to succeed in many other industries, because we have a very unique product that we're selling. We're selling an experience, and that's very different than a lot of other industries. So let's dive into some of these different marketing methods and what we see working. We shared a few case studies kind of along at the beginning today, and we want to just kind of dive in and look at some other things here today. We like to ask that question as far as how many of us are sending email campaigns at least monthly. And usually about half the room kind of hesitantly raised their hand. We talked earlier that you really need to be sending campaigns twice per month. But it's here to serve two main purposes for you: staying top of mind and staying relevant with your database. It's going to help you turn past guests into repeat guests and earn referrals from past guests. And even if someone doesn't open your email marketing campaign, it's still valuable. It has still accomplished the purpose of being top of mind with that person, which is a great thing to accomplish. So definitely you need to be focused on sending more email in the coming year. So again, that recommendation, send two campaigns per month every single month. And you can usually break this down into two. You find the rhythm that works for you. But what we'll often do is push specials or packages, which is kind of more of a sales email. And then the other email campaign we send that month, we'll share more relevant content and reasons to visit. So if you have a great festival happening, I saw on Facebook that from one of our friends up in Kennebunk, that the Kennebunk Christmas tree lighting was last week, I think. That's a great thing, right? If you're in Kennebunk or you're near that destination in Maine, you should be sharing that. You should be promoting that a month ahead of time and really pushing that message out. People that have stayed with you in the past and they've fallen in love with your little town would love to come back and check that out and really be able to have that experience. But you've got to tell them. You've got to give them the reason to visit and showcase that for them. And if you give them reasons to come back, they will come back. They already know you. They already love you. They just need reasons to come back and visit again. And that's a great way to drive shoulder season or off-season business. And your relevant content's the same way. Sharing blog posts about stuff going on in the area, getting yourself found for those things via email and search will really help you as you're doing, as you're working towards getting found for some of this shoulder season and off-season business. And then as you're doing that, make sure that you're tracking it, right? So the most important metrics to track are traffic and open rate. Traffic obviously is important because that's people actually going to your website to check something out. But open rate is very important as well. It's the people that connected with your message and making sure you're testing things to drive traffic and open rate higher. Doing A/B testing, doing subject line grading, doing a lot of these things that can help your email marketing perform better and better every time you send it. And then as you work towards that, set the goal to achieve a 10% click-through monthly from your database. You know, that screenshot we talked about earlier, just with seeing those spikes in traffic every month. The industry average is a 2% click-through for the travel segment of the industry. If we're sending two campaigns per month, that means that we're going to get about 4% of our database clicking through. We believe that if you do a great job, you're going to outperform the industry average. The average is established for a reason, right? It means there's a lot of people lower than that, and there's some people higher than that as well. So we set the goal of a 4 to 5% click-through on every campaign we send out. So if you combine that 4 to 5 click-through with two campaigns, you're going to have an 8 to 10% click-through rate. So if you think about how big your database is, say you've got 10,000 people in your database, and 10% of those click through in a given month, you should be getting about 1,000 visits a month from email marketing. And if you're not doing email marketing, that's about what you're missing out on, about 10% of your database clicking through, 8 to 10%. Next thing we're going to do is switch gears here and talk about blogging a little bit. I talked to you about how much success we've seen with that this year. And as you're really diving into that, it's not just about writing whatever comes to mind. It's about writing things that people are actually searching for and doing your keyword research ahead of time to know what those things are, knowing what people are searching for, when they're searching for it, and developing your content strategy 30, 60, 90 days ahead of that peak search traffic for a specific keyword. So you've really got to be thinking about, am I blogging weekly? Am I ready and willing to commit to writing a 500 to 700 word blog post every single week? The proof is in the pudding. You know, websites who actively blog, and we've seen this. This is a national statistic from HubSpot, which is a marketing software company that pulls a lot of data together. But what they have seen is that sites or websites that actively blog see 55% more traffic than those that don't. We see a much stronger percentage. It's more like 75 to 100% more traffic for sites that blog weekly than those that don't, as far as we look at our customer base. So it's much more dramatic. I think a lot of that is because of the industry we're specifically working in, is one that lends itself very, very well to a great blogging strategy. And again, it's not just whatever comes to mind. It's a very strategic, keyword-focused blog. And you've got to make sure you're publishing those on a weekly basis. So here's a quick example. Weekend getaways near Cincinnati. If you have a destination near Cincinnati and people live in Cincinnati, and good Lord knows they want to get out of Cincinnati, right? Don't we all want to get out of Cincinnati? My apologies to any of you who live in Cincinnati, but the good news is there are places you can get to that are not far away that are actually better than that. Maybe it's your Bengals are losing. Maybe it's the fact that it's 4 degrees. Who knows why you want to get out of town, but you want to get out of town. And we wrote this blog to help our customer that's near Cincinnati get ranked to reach travelers who are living in Cincinnati and who are looking for a weekend getaway. We wrote that blog actually in 2014, and still in 2015, it has driven tremendous success for us. We'll zoom in here a little bit. You can see that this year to date, we have had 3,193 visits. This was through the end of November, just on this one blog post. So one blog post, that's a lot of people trying to get out of Cincinnati, y'all. I don't know about you, but that's a shocking number of people trying to get the heck out of Cincinnati. but 3,193 people have discovered our customers' property, destination, lodging option, discovered that whole experience by Googling weekend getaways near Cincinnati. Tremendous opportunity to reach travelers looking to take a weekend getaway. And that's just one example of many. There's hundreds I could show you. That's just one we wanted to really highlight because it's a cool example, and it shows just a different way about thinking about your blog and thinking about the drive markets around you that you might be able to employ a strategy like that to reach. And as we talk about goal setting, we would encourage you to set the goal to drive 700 visits a month from blogging. That is absolutely attainable by the end of your first year, and I would say in your second year, it's probably you can exceed that, 1,000 plus visits a month from your blog in your second year. But know that it's going to take 3 to 6 months to start gaining traction, so be patient. Regardless of the destination, regardless of the season that we launch in, every time we launch a new customer, we see a very similar graph to this. What this shows us is these first three dots here, these represent the first 3 months. And you'll notice that line is almost entirely flat. There's a slight uptick, but very, very little. And then the fourth dot, the fifth dot, the sixth dot, and then that spike for the seventh dot. Again, each dot represents a month. And what we see here is that it takes 3 to 6 months to really start getting traction. And again, we see that every time. And I believe Google knows that. I believe Google says, hey, I know most people will quit. If they've been writing a blog post every week that's 500 to 700 words and it's done all the research and it's great quality, you're going to spend 4 or 5 hours writing a blog post and doing all that research like that. You do it every single week. You do it for 3 months. And by the end of those 3 months, you're probably going to be cursing me, because you're going to be upset you're seeing zero results. And at that point, you will most likely quit. Most people would quit, right? They've invested all that time. We're talking about 35 to 40 hours of your precious time you've invested at this point and seen almost zero results from it, you would most definitely quit. But what happens is something magic in that fourth through seventh month. And in the second year, it gets even stronger. But the amount of traffic we get, the amount of traction we get from the strategy, if we commit to posting weekly and don't miss a week, you have a phenomenal amount of traffic you can capture. And ultimately, it's not just traffic. These are people discovering your destination, discovering you when they're planning a vacation, right? I mean, how much better does it get than that? Someone's planning a vacation and they discover you and they didn't previously know you existed. That's it. That's what marketing is all about. We're going to touch base on social media real quickly so we have some time for questions and answer here. How many of us have active Facebook pages that we're managing? I'm still shocked how many people don't have active Facebook pages. And I'm not all that shocked, but know that over 95% of people can't hit this goal of growing at 5 to 10% per month. The industry average is about 10% growth per year. So growing at 10% per month would mean they're essentially 12 times the industry average from a growth perspective. But again, it's important to build that audience because as you're building that audience, you're going to help yourself reach more people. Here's one quick example of a way to keep your edge rank high by creating great engaging content. Share great photos of your area and property. Ask people for the like, comment, and share. Really connect with stuff that's interesting to people. So here's a blog post that we wrote, 10 of the most fascinating historic homes in Lehigh Valley. And of course, Sarah Mansion, which is a boutique hotel, bed and breakfast in the Lehigh Valley. It's one of our favorite customers. They are on this list, right? They're one of the beautiful historic homes, but we also highlighted 9 others and shared this blog post. In the first week or two we posted that, we reached 11,039 people with 166 likes, comments, and shares, and 529 post clicks. Tremendous amount of traffic coming back to our website, tremendous amount of people discovering the Sarah Mansion through this blog post. This isn't even one we would consider that went viral. We have posts in the six figures from a total reach perspective and the double digits from a traffic, or excuse me, the double digits from thousands of people reaching the website, 30, 40,000 people discovering the destination from a blog. But this is how an integrated marketing strategy can really work for you. You write great blog content, you share it very well in your social media presence, and then you drive people to discover your destination through that strategy. So tremendous opportunity to make that work for you. And then again, reinforcing that, set the goal to grow a 5 to 10% per month. Can't stress how important that is, so we kind of always try to end all of our marketing methods with a strong goal for you. Search engine optimization isn't last because we think it's least important. It's just last because it's an area we know you guys are already spending a lot of time learning and researching and hopefully doing well. But how many of us are really doing ongoing SEO on a monthly basis? Some changes Google has made this year make it even more important than ever to be doing ongoing SEO or at least ongoing monitoring of your SEO. We have seen this year you haven't heard of any big shocking announcements from Google in a while, and that is on purpose. Google has let us know that they're going to be making constant little changes, not major newsworthy ones. Believe it or not, they don't like to be in the news for algorithm updates because as soon as that news comes out, the next article that's right after it is how do we beat this new change? And that's not what they want. They don't want people trying to figure out how to beat their change. So instead of rolling out these major algorithm updates and so forth and doing it kind of 2-3 times a year, they're making constant minor changes to the algorithm that are much harder to spot, but you've got to be in there on a regular basis to see if you're if any of those changes are impacting you. And then being able to really identify what it was if you are impacted by one, either in a negative way, which is the worst case scenario, but it's equally important or more important maybe to identify it if it's a positive way. Because if you got impacted positively by a change, you want to know how can I do more of that, right? If Google is rewarding that activity, how can I do more of that in my strategy to get more traffic and more bookings from that source? And if you haven't put together the fact that your SEO and your content creation or blogging strategy should be going hand in hand, right? If you have an SEO strategy not part of a blogging strategy, you're doing SEO but not doing blogging, then you are absolutely missing the boat. If you haven't put that together by this point, you're probably about 3 to 5 years behind from a marketing perspective. And more importantly, if the marketing company that you're partnered with from an SEO perspective hasn't put that together and isn't leading that conversation with you, headed into 2016, how might be a good time to consider making a change, because it really needs to be going hand in hand. You may have heard people say SEO is dead, but in reality, SEO is not dead. It's just different, right? Everything is changing, and you've got to be staying on top of that. And that's the major, one of the major changes from an SEO perspective that has happened, is that SEO and blogging or content creation are hand in hand in today's modern marketing world. You've got to be pushing that envelope to succeed. And then as we look at goals, set the goal to increase traffic from organic search by 20%. We set that goal across our customer base and routinely beat that goal year after year after year. We've talked to a lot of people in the last 30 days who organic search traffic is down year over year. Talked to somebody yesterday in Hawaii whose traffic was down 50%. So we know a lot of people's traffic is down. Not everybody is up and to the right, but you absolutely can have your traffic up by 20% or more. You just have to have a plan and a strategy to do that, and then execute that plan on a regular basis, and you can absolutely achieve traffic growth from this. And as we know, Google Organic is one of the highest quality sources of traffic that we have. It's really, really important to be growing this element of our traffic and having a plan and a strategy to do that. The last thing we want to touch base on here, and I'm going to touch on it again. We spent a lot of time touching on it at the beginning, but that's analytics tracking. You have to be in your data at least monthly to really understand where your traffic and bookings are coming from, looking for any red flags or those places that you're losing traffic from, sources of traffic that are down year over year, and why are they down, and how do you develop a plan to get them back up. You've got to be in that data on a regular basis to understand that. I can't stress that enough, and it still shocks me every time I talk to business owners and how few of them are in their data on a regular basis, or when the last time they were. And if you're in that place, don't feel bad about that. Everybody is in that place. Everybody we talk to tells us they're not in their analytics enough, and we're here to help you with that, and I'm going to talk about that in just a minute. But you've got to be able to do that. You've got to set a goal to review this at least monthly in 2016 and do a deep analysis here at the end of the year. And if you are working with a marketing partner, you should be leaning on them to lead this discussion with you. They should be sending you reports, helping you understand what's going on from a traffic perspective. I kind of oftentimes correlated to that grade card we all had in elementary school, right? We all got our grades, and if we had good grades, we ran home every day, and we wanted to tell mom about our good grades. We wanted to go get ice cream cone. We wanted to put it on the refrigerator. When your kids come home from school and they don't have good grades, they don't want to talk about it. They want to hide it. So in the same way, if your marketing company is coming back and they have great results, chances are they want to send you a report. They want to come back. They want to get that, hey, look how good things are. Everything's awesome. If they're not wanting to have that conversation, chances are it means something's not good. And you need to dive a little bit deeper into understanding that. But you should be leaning on them to lead that conversation for you. And then the last thing here before we kind of get into some Q&A, is ROI. You've got to understand what ROI is, how you're going to measure it, and have a plan to be able to do that effectively. We believe, and we set the goal as a company, to achieve a 200 to 300% return on investment for every one of our customers. So if they're investing $1 into marketing, we want to drive $2 to $3 back as a return on investment for their business to help them grow their business, because ultimately, marketing is an investment in the growth of your business, not an expense. And that's how you should be looking at that. So I talked about some things, but now it's really time to take action, right? So all these goals together, you have to set the goal to take action in 2016. But as I talked about, those companies that really see the best results in 2016 are the companies that will start early, and they'll kick off 2016 with a bang by charging into that aggressively. So don't wait to start. If you wait to start, you'll fall behind in the first quarter of the year, and then most likely will end up missing your goals for the year as a whole. So we're here to help you do that. You've been on our webinars, you know we always try to be a resource to the community, and one of the ways we really have found we can help people is to help them just get into their analytics. Dive into your Google Analytics and do an in-depth analysis, kind of like what we did in the first half of our call here together today, but really help you understand what are your highest performing traffic sources, what are your lowest performing traffic sources, what have you done well this year from a marketing perspective, and how is it performing, have you gotten a return on that investment? help you understand some of those things. So after the webinar today, we'll be sending out an email for you to take an opportunity to request a free analytics analysis. It's about a 15, 30-minute call. We'll jump on via GoToMeeting with you and just help you understand some of that data, what's working, what's not, and then give you kind of some ideas, some action items to jumpstart you on your strategy for 2016. So definitely encourage you to take advantage of that if getting a plan together for 2016 is something that's on your mind. So let's dive into some Q&A. I know we've been getting a lot of questions in the chat panel throughout our time together today, so excited to jump into those. But if you're looking for my contact information, if you have questions you want to connect on personally, it's there on the screen. So encourage you to do that. But we'll dive into the chat panel here and see if we can get some of these questions answered. Awesome. All right, a question here from Mike. Is 2% conversion rate an industry average? There's a lot of debate on that, and you can't really just take a blanket average because, of course, the quality of traffic or the traffic source varies. But if we see a 1% conversion rate in analytics and a company gets half of their bookings online and half of their bookings via the phone, then we double that 1% conversion rate to a 2% conversion rate, right? Because 1% of people book online, 1% of people book by phone. So now we know 2% of our traffic is converting into booking. So yeah, Mike, the answer is we do use that kind of as an industry average, but it varies a little bit by traffic source. And we have some deeper metrics on each traffic source, how much conversion we expect to see there based on the quality of that traffic. Follow-up question here from Mike. What analytics drill down did you go to find travelers finding your blog details? That's all about if your blog is set up properly in the first place. If you have your blog set up to be able to track this way, we go into landing pages, which is under that same behavior, site content, landing pages that I referenced earlier, left-hand menu, behavior, site content, landing pages in Google Analytics. And then we do a search for any URL that contains the term blog in it. So we set up all of our customers' blogs to have that URL, so it'd be /blog/blog title, so that we can track that appropriately. If your web developer wasn't really thinking about marketing and tracking when they set that up, you might not be set up that way. But that's how we go about tracking those things. And again, Mike, great opportunity to connect on the analytics analysis, and we'll see if we can dive into your data to help you figure that out. Question here from Tyler. What subjects are they blogging about? That's a great question. It's all over the place. I mean, we're writing, at this point, 300 to 400 blogs a month. So you can imagine we're writing about a lot of subjects. But really, it comes down to doing the keyword research to see what are people searching for when they're planning a trip to your destination, Tyler. And we do that through the Google Keyword Planner tool that actually lives inside of Google AdWords. So you can set up a free AdWords account and use their Keyword Planner as a free tool to really dive in and figure out what people are searching for when they're coming to your area, and then planning your blog content strategy around that. We do that on a quarterly basis. So we figure out all the blogs we're going to write for the quarter coming up and how much search traffic there is and when we need to write it to get it ranked in time to capitalize on that. Question here from Paula. How do you measure ROI on Facebook, Twitter, etc.? It's difficult. Some of it is traffic. Some of it is specific to certain campaigns we would be running. You can do some of it with traffic through some retargeting and remarketing and some things like that with the tracking pixel Facebook has available. But it is more difficult than some of the other mediums. But you can see it through traffic direct to bookings. If you have booking conversions set up in your analytics, you can also see it through doing some of the specific campaigns and measuring that. So good question, Paula. Also a question here from Paula. What is a good free keyword search site? I answered that a little bit for Tyler, but using the Google Keyword Planner, that's a part of Google AdWords. Some questions here from June. If we follow your advice for email marketing and blogging, can we cancel our subscription to BnB.com, BnB Finder, and I Love Inns? I am never sure if it does a thing to be part of those places, but I tell myself to put this online at different places. That's a big question, June, and the real answer is based on your own situation and how much availability you have, how much of that you're looking to fill, some of those types of things. Ultimately, if you're happy with the amount of business that you have and you're just looking to do one instead of the other, you could, I would say it's fair to assume you could replace the traffic you have from those other directory listings, and that goes for any directory listing, with an email marketing and blogging strategy if you do that well. I wouldn't probably cancel any third-party directories until you have gone about replacing that traffic you got from them. And then you still have to make a decision of, okay, is that listing providing a return on investment? Because if you've increased your traffic and you're getting a return on investment there, but you're still getting a return on investment from the directory, you may not cancel it. You may just have even more bookings than you had before. So it's a very unique answer to that question. You can't really make a blanket answer for everybody without knowing their specific situation and data. What about main interstate signs? Can they work? It costs, but I wonder if you have any experience with that. Another question from June there. Honestly, June, we don't have a lot of experience from interstate signs. It's not part of a marketing medium that we really participate in. We have a customer. I think we only have one or two customers that I know of that have them, and they've had mixed results. I mean, they can be expensive, and they've definitely got some business from them, but it hasn't always been the type of business that they wanted either, the type of transient business that sees a sign and just stops. Isn't always the type of business that they're looking for. The people that are really planning a vacation, are more what they're after usually, and making a longer stay. Some other questions here from Tyler. Social media, isn't that changing since you can buy from Facebook? Yes, absolutely. Social media is changing. Everything is changing. Is the short answer to that question. And you've got to be adapting your strategy based off of what is working today and testing things. Test, test, test. We can't stress that enough. How do you find out what people are looking for blog subjects and know that those are the people you want to target? Well, you find out what they're looking for with the resources we've talked about, which I know you asked that question before I answered that question, so no worries on that. But then how do you know that they're people you want to target? You've got to think about the type of person that would be searching that. And say, okay, if a person is searching X, is that the type of person that we want to target? Is that person planning a trip, or are they doing something else? And if they are planning a trip, is that the type of guest that I want? You know, if they're coming in for the Harley-Davidson Festival, I have a lot of customers that say, I love Harley. That's the kind of customer I want. And I've got some customers who would say they have a persona on what Harley-Davidson enthusiasts are like, and they don't want that customer. So you've got to be thinking about that as well and kind of targeting that. And in reality, as with anything, there will be a certain percentage of those people that are the exact customer you want. They're the perfect customer, and a certain percentage of people that aren't the right customer. And that's just kind of the way it is, and you're going to track some of that with all of it, but you've got to, you can then price and some of those other things can weed that out a little bit. Question here from Sharon Roberts. What is your basic monthly cost for your services? Great question, Sharon. We'd be happy to connect with you one-on-one and answer that. If anybody else has that question, we'd be happy to connect with you as well. Our main purpose today is really to educate more than try to do anything else, so we'd be happy to connect with you, Sharon, to dive into a little bit more about what it looks like to work with us and drive that 200 to 300% return on your investment. Question from Bob. Do I need to refresh an old blog? Lots of things you could mean there, Bob. As far as refreshing design, I would say absolutely. Design of blog is very, very important, especially if people are going to be entering your website via the blog. If you're talking about an old blog that's getting traffic and needing to refresh that content, possibly. If a blog is ranked and it's for a event or a holiday or a festival that happens every year, and that blog did get ranked and is bringing you traffic, you can refresh that blog instead of writing an all new one, so just updating that content. If the blog didn't get ranked, chances are there was something Google didn't like about it, so why refresh it? Just go ahead and write a new one because Google didn't like it in the first place. Question from Mark. Should your Facebook post be linked to your website or blog? If so, how often? Absolutely, Mark. They should be. I wouldn't say there's a set number of how often. Maybe 10 to 25% of the time you should be linking back to your website. Not all the time, but depends on what the quality of the content is. Question from Mike. Is remarketing a worthwhile marketing strategy? Again, very difficult to make blanket statements like that. But yes, in general, yes, it absolutely is something worth looking at. You just have to have a plan to measure the ROI, and then you'll know 30, 60, 90 days later if it was worthwhile for you after you've been able to tweak that strategy and develop an ROI. Question from Mark. If we are currently not using OTAs and doing fine, should we not start using them even for slower shoulder season? you know, it depends on what you mean by doing fine, Mark. Are you doing fine, but you want to be doing better? It's not one of the strategies I would jump on first, but it is one of the easiest things to do. You know, it's a lot easier than doing the things we've talked about here today. But you think about the marketing cost for those is pretty high as well. So you got to factor that into your overall equation and making that decision. Be happy to help you dive deeper into your own data. A couple thank yous for the webinar today. We'll call out those individually, but you're welcome. Glad you joined us. Hopefully it was helpful for you. And then a question here from Micah again. If you refresh a blog that is performing well, is there anything to avoid doing to not screw it up? Yeah, I think changing the URL is one of those things. If you do change it, make sure that you put a redirect in so Google knows where that blog moved to as far as the new URL destination for it. And then just the overall content of it. You know, if you're updating or refreshing a blog because the event has, you know, the dates have changed, just change the dates. You probably don't need to do the whole thing if it's already performing well. Just keep your changes to a minimum if it's already performing well. So I think that's it. A couple more compliments popping in. Thank you all for those. I appreciate that. Glad to know it's been helpful for you. I always appreciate your feedback on our webinars. So thank you for your comments there. Thanks everyone for your attendance as well. It's a little after 3, so we're going to kind of wrap this up. If you have additional questions or you'd like to take advantage of that Google Analytics analysis, please do email or call us. We'd be happy to get that out for you or watch for that email from me. Thanks everybody for your time today, and we will look forward to talking with you soon.